Inderdaad, de Partij voor de Dieren houdt zich maar met één ding bezig. En daar zijn we uniek in. Kies Partij voor de Dieren.
Thank you. Thank you. Sure, we only have one thing on our mind. All of the parties' concerns and solutions have a planet-wide scope. And that makes us one of a kind. That is what we are going to talk about today, here in the historic chambers of the Dutch Parliament. We still look pretty good from a distance, a planet with a capacity for humans and animals to live in mutual harmony. In the history of the world, 547 astronauts were given the opportunity to glimpse our planet from a distance. They tell us that it's not easier to be happier there far away. And yet, there are still people making plans to settle down on planet Mars for good. Barren place. But some of the super rich, such as Elon Musk, dream of building a new civilization there. So, what happened to ours? Gandhi was once asked what he thought of Western civilization. And he said, "I think that would be a really good idea. A civilization that protects the interests from the weakest, from the assumed rights of the strongest. And yet, we still haven't managed it. Of course, we have taken steps forward. We are better informed than ever before. But at the same time, we also refuse to take responsibility for all those things that we can be reasonably assumed to know, but choose to ignore. We know, for instance, perfectly well who make our clothes, and that it happens under appalling conditions, so that we can buy our shirts cheap. We know that we are killing our oceans, fishing at bearing of life. And we know that temperatures on Earth are rising at a dangerous rate. We know that an increasing number of people do not have access to fresh drinking water. We know that rainforests are being cleared to give us inexpensive beef. And we know that calves are taken away from their mothers immediately after birth to give us low-priced milk. And of course we know that billions of little roosters on the day they hatch are fed through shredders simply because they have no economic value. But because we have the feeling that we cannot do anything about it or that it's hard to change, we sometimes prefer to look the other way. What went wrong? Where did we go wrong? Steve Katz has made an amazing animation about those questions. Man, about the history of that very intelligent species which has become a nuisance to its own habitat. Thank you. What wake-up call does the world need? From the instant that astronaut Wibble Ockels saw the Earth from a distance, he dedicated his life to sustainable choices. He realized that we are living on a planet that has completely lost its balance. Imagine a planet on which the sales of Rolls Royces during a time of crisis are higher than ever before. During a crisis, more Rolls Royces than ever before. A planet where 1 billion people go to bed hungry every night, yet also a planet where 1 billion people struggle with obesity. A planet where, according to the Hopi Indians, we have become to live like madness, live in discord, live in imbalance, live in disintegration. A way of life that demands another way of life. On board of the space shuttle Challenger, Wibble Ockels thought of the metaphor of spaceship Earth. A spaceship with 7 billion souls on board, where everyone is completely disconnected. Where your money has become more important than your life. A planet that is gravely ill, but where many astronauts deny the illness or do not want to think about it. And a few astronauts do issue warnings, but do not want to be considered doomsday preachers, the bearers of bad tidings. Ockels is not the first to warn us. In 1776, in his book The Wealth of Nations, economist Adam Smith predicted a period of unprecedented affluence, a period in which the economy would be highly evolved, a period of profound knowledge of the use of resources that would lead to unbridled prosperity. That prediction came to pass. For generations, children have been more intelligent, wealthy, healthy, and successful than their parents were. Until our generation, we are the first to worry about whether our children will do better than we did, both in material and in immaterial sense. Adam Smith also predicted that back in 1776. He estimated that after approximately 200 years, the free market economy would go haywire due to a lack of resources. But hey, 200 years, that's a long time. And when, nearly 200 years after Adam Smith's doom-mongering, the Club of Rome introduced the phrase limits to growth in the 1970s. In the 1970s, the supermarkets were stocked to the ceiling, fuller than ever. And blue-collar workers in the West found themselves in a position where they could consider buying a second car or booking a third vacation. We didn't have mobile phones then, we had no internet, but we were doing perfectly fine. Limits to growth? Yeah, right. Many people were just starting to feel the first tickle of that euphoric, magical sense that the sky's the limit. Since then, we have become richer than ever, but we've also received a wealth of warnings. The problem is that we've become used to the Earth's flexibility and maintain an unchanged faith in human ingenuity. We know that we need full planet Earth to allow everyone the same consumption pattern that we have in the West. We also know that those four Earths simply don't exist. Not even if we take billionaire Elon Musk's Mars colony into account. We mindlessly continue to gamble on more. Larger factory farms, genetically manipulated crops, bigger trawlers, larger scale deforestation. We are all scrambling to secure our fair share, more, before it becomes less. The economy has become fully dependent on growth. Compare it to a Ponzi scheme. It's fully dependent on new participants to put in new stakes to remain afloat. No growth means no prosperity, no jobs. No growth means no fun. And so on our own small planet with a growing population, we are putting our faith in economic growth as the big gun solution to all ailments. Because politicians, fossil politicians, say that everything will be all right as long as the economy starts to grow again. If we squeeze that very last drop of fossil fuel from our Earth, by means of fracking if need to be, then at least our generation will be all right. This is a summary drafted by the Post-Carbon Institute.
You heard them. Politicians, economists, executives, all saying the same thing. The economy is recovering. Recovering to what? To its normal state of constant growth. In the next 5 minutes, we're going to see why they're wrong, why economic growth is effectively over, and what that means for the economy, for you, and for your family. It started a couple of centuries ago. There had been economic expansion before, but it was slow and cyclical. Empires rose and fell. But with the Industrial Revolution, rapid growth became normal. Economists tell us this was because of innovation, division of labor, increased trade. But it was mostly a result of cheap energy. It takes energy to do things, and with cheap coal and oil, people could suddenly do more than ever. First coal and then oil sped up trade by fueling our prized inventions. Railroads, automobiles, and airplanes. Economists assumed that growth could go on forever. It was an absurd notion. Nobody stopped to think that all this industrial growth was happening on a small planet with only so much oil and soil, only so many forests and fish. We were growing on borrowed time. But we all got hooked on growth. Rising GDP numbers became our main measure of success. More, bigger, and faster meant better. The first warning sign came in the 1970s. A team of scientists programmed a computer with data about population growth, rising consumption, and resource depletion. Their conclusion: there are limits to growth. Mainstream economists attacked those findings using nasty rhetorical tricks, but 40 years later, the same conclusion holds. In fact, the industrial economies of the world's wealthy nations started stagnating years ago as resources began to run out. Governments, businesses, and households went into hock up to their eyeballs, gorging on easy credit. The financial system created ever more complex securities and derivative schemes to soak up all that debt and make perpetually rising imaginary profits on imaginary assets. But money and debt depend on natural resources. Piling up debt year after year, doubling it and doubling it again, meant piling up claims on resources that were shrinking as we depleted them. It was a pyramid scheme, the mother of all bubbles. And in 2008, it burst. Governments and central banks tried to reinflate the bubble with bailouts and stimulus packages funded by public debt. But there are practical limits to debt, and we're hitting them. There are practical limits to energy sources, and we're hitting them. There are real limits to the planet's ability to absorb our wastes and industrial accidents, and we've hit those too. We're being told that the economy is recovering, but take away new debt the government has taken on since 2008 to stimulate the economy, and there's been no real economic growth. There is no recovery. It's all been done with more debt. We've already mortgaged our grandchildren's future, but to keep the economy from relapsing, we'll need to borrow even more. The game is up. We've reached the end of economic growth as we've known it. They're lying to you, but they can't help it. We're all addicted to growth. We all want better jobs and higher returns on investments, but we live on a finite planet. The end of growth is not the fault of any one politician or political party, but some people benefited from growth more than others. We can live without economic growth, but we'll have to start doing a few things differently. We have to measure and aim for improvements in life that don't require increasing our consumption of fossil fuels and other depleting resources, or piling on more debt. Freedom. Being with the people we love, good health and the time to enjoy it, a secure, happy community. We have to work together to build local economies where we can live and prosper. But, and this is a big but, without cheap fossil fuels and without borrowing from the future. The longer we put this off, the harder it will be. Economic growth, it's over. Let's move on.
Our current behavior has caused the ecological debt to become 10 times the size of the financial budget deficit of most European countries.
The ecological footprint is an accounting tool, not for money, but for ecological resources. So it compares how much nature we have and how much nature we use. Over the last 40 years, we've just had one planet. That's why the line of supply is very, very horizontal. Humanity has been continuously increasing its resource demand.
To the extent that by the 70s, we started to use more than what nature can regenerate. Currently, we're using at least 50% more than what nature can renew. This means it takes about 1 year and 6 months to regenerate what people use in 1 year. So we are in global overshoot.
Overshoot can be thought of as living off of your credit card. You know, humanity's living off its ecological credit card. If we use more than nature can keep up with, we actually start to erode natural capital that life depends on.
Currently, if everyone on Earth lived as North Americans do, we'd need four Earths. For everyone to live as Europeans do would take 2.5 Earths. In other regions, people are living beyond the capacity of one Earth as well. China and India are presently living just around the one Earth level. But given the rapid industrialization and economic growth of both countries, that's sure to change.
A key component of humanity's ecological footprint is the burning of fossil fuels. The carbon dioxide released into the atmosphere is causing the Earth's surface to heat up, disrupting global climate patterns. In a series of comprehensive reports, the largest group of scientists ever assembled on a single issue has warned that unless we act now, it is extremely likely that climate change will have devastating impacts on the future of life on Earth.
Well, are things really that depressing? Will the pessimists defeat the optimists? Let me tell you, I am an optimist. I have founded the Party for the Animals based on the understanding that man is a product and part of nature and should not be placed himself at the center of life. A party that is committed to protecting everything that is valuable and vulnerable, where the interest of the animals, of nature, and the environment must be taken seriously, planet-wide. We Dutch conquered our land from the water. Our grandparents made the Flevopolder. Our parents built the Delta Works. What are we going to do? There's no need to get depressed about the fact that we, as humans, are the cause of these major problems, because we can also be part of the solution. We can evolve into a generation of problem solvers, a generation that uses smart technology and common sense to stop our downfall, a generation that is able to see beyond its own lifespan. We can easily cut our ecological footprint in half. We just have to want it. And we can offer our children a bright future if we are willing to learn from our mistakes. If we really want to, there is so much we can do. And we have every reason not to translate every wish or need into money. Am I naive? Is this wishful thinking? I don't think so. I think it's naive to be blindsided by money, as if that represents a value in its own right. Let's take a different perspective on four topics that during our own lifetime could potentially become issues of massive proportions. I have asked scientists to offer their opinions on the system crisis that we are now confronted with, who are also willing and able to work on solutions to those problems. Let's not wait until the traditional political leaders come with solutions. They were at the very root of our current problems, or in the very least, didn't intervene when they first surfaced. Let's work together to create solutions ourselves. The revolution has to start somewhere. I would like to talk to you about diseases, about nature, about water, and about food. In fact, about the preconditions to our existence and the futures of our children and grandchildren worldwide, because there is no Planet B. In 2014, I received a message from Dr. Olga Jones from the World Bank. She asked me if I would be interested in setting up an appointment. The World Bank, I don't have a checking account with them, so I'm certainly not overdrawn. Why on earth would someone from the World Bank want to meet with me? But if someone from Washington is willing to come to The Hague for an appointment, there must be something going on. And so I made an appointment with her, with this economic advisor of the World Bank. Olga Jonas told me she was extremely concerned about the growing number of animal disease crises, that we are so poorly prepared, and that so few people seem aware of the immense danger looming over our heads. Of course, when enormous outbreaks of illnesses such as swine fever, bird flu, Ebola, EHEC, or SARS occur, we all worry. Suddenly, you see people on the streets wearing face masks. Passengers' planes are checked more carefully, and animal transports are cancelled. But as soon as the threat dies down, interest in the topic also fades away. And this was a major concern to Olga Jonas. So major, in fact, that she decided to make an appointment with NATO in Brussels. According to the World Health Organization and the World Bank, a pandemic could claim more casualties than any war ever has. So it makes sense to talk with NATO and ask NATO what it plans to do to protect the world from this danger. NATO's answer was unequivocal. There was nothing they could do to prevent a pandemic. NATO could only help once the pandemic was a fact, but only in terms of solving immediate logistic and safety issues. Who do you call when NATO can't help? The Party for the Animals, of course. Not such a stretch, really, when you consider the fact that of all bacteria and viruses that can make people sick, 75% is of animal origin. These are called zoonoses, but what are those exactly?
This is swine flu. Made simple. Flu is a virus that attacks the respiratory system by infecting and destroying cell tissue in the lungs. There are many different types of flu viruses, each with a unique genetic fingerprint. Some target certain species, such as the human flu, bird flu, and swine flu. These generally don't intermix. Most of us have gotten the human flu at some point in our lives. We feel lousy and run a high fever, but usually make a full recovery within a week or so. As part of this recovery, our immune system creates antibodies, which act as a defense against future infection from the same virus. Many people get the flu vaccination, which also provides these same antibodies. As a result, at any given time, a large part of the population is immune to the human flu. As you can see, this helps prevent widespread infection. So how is the swine flu different from the human flu? First off, the term swine flu is a little misleading. The new flu virus is actually a combination of three types of flu: human flu, bird flu, and swine flu. This mutation is dangerous for several reasons. First, because it contains traces of the human flu, it inherits the ability to transmit from human to human. But since it also contains traces of the bird and swine flu, which aren't recognized by our immune systems, the antibodies we have can't protect us. As a result, the swine flu can spread rapidly through the population, infecting millions of people at once. We call this a pandemic.
Animals become sick because of the way they are kept by humans. And humans become sick because of the way we keep animals. To increase production, animals are kept in massive numbers and in unnatural conditions. And farmers want the animals to grow quickly. So they sprinkle antibiotics before animals are even ill. The result is that the animal's immune system are compromised and bacteria become desensitized to antibiotics. Nearly all the chicken meat and nearly half of the veal in the Netherlands is infected with multi-resistant ESBL bacteria. And over half of the cultivated tiger prawns and tilapia from Southeast Asia sold here is infected with multi-resistant bacteria. MRSL and ESBL multi-resistant bacteria don't necessarily make people ill, but because they are no longer sensitive to antibiotics, it is becoming more likely that diseases that are now relatively easy to cure, such as cystitis, may literally become life-threatening in the future. Between 2007 and 2011, there was a major outbreak of the zoonotic Q fever in the Dutch goat sector. People traveling to the Netherlands from the US and Brazil, for example, were advised by their governments to refrain from cycling or hiking in the affected areas. Q fever is so dangerous that the bacteria is listed as a biological weapon. And yet, the residents of the infected area received no warning whatsoever by the Dutch government. 4,000 people were infected. Hundreds still suffer chronic ailments today. 25 people died and 50,000 goats were killed, both sick and healthy animals.
In december vorig jaar werden honderden geiten onderzocht bij boer Van Loon in Vinkel en de drachtige beesten werden gedood. Om zeker te zijn dat hele kleine vruchten er niet doorheen zouden glippen, deed de Voedsel- en Warenautoriteit het 6 weken later nog eens dunnetjes over. Ook toen met een grote ruimploeg.
Plus minus 15, 20 ongeveer, die hier de hele dag aanwezig zijn geweest.
Twee dagen.
Twee dagen nu al. Ja. Ze zijn al 2 keer hier geweest.
En zo ging het ook op meer dan 60 andere geitenhouderijen. Een operatie waarbij honderden mensen zijn betrokken en die miljoenen euro's kost. Maar ondanks al die inzet gaat het niet foutloos.
We are all familiar with bird flu and swine fever, although their names have been creatively disguised as avian influenza and Mexican flu, because it would be utterly unacceptable for the pork and chicken industries to get a bad rap due to potential pandemic, of course. Animal diseases are of all times, but with our worldwide practices of keeping some 70 billion animals for consumption, 70 billion each year, we have unwittingly created a ticking time bomb for pandemics on an immeasurable scale. Viruses and bacteria can transmit to the human who looks after, transports, slaughters, or eats an animal. But the greatest danger is posed by diseases that have been transmitted from animal to human, but which can also be transmitted from human to human. The most severe of the 4 flu pandemics that raged in the past 100 years was the Spanish flu, a zoonosis that mutated into a virus that was transmittable from human to human. Scholars are still researching the exact number of casualties and the source of the infection. But we know for sure that at least dozens of millions and possibly hundreds of millions died as a result. If that same flu pandemic were to break out today, the World Bank estimates that it would claim the lives of many times that number. According to the International Livestock Research Institute, any individual flu pandemic would incur over $3,000 billion in costs. We know that a number of bird flu viruses are only 2 or 3 mutations away from being transmittable from human to human. Cheap eggs, milk, and drumsticks apparently are more important than protecting our children and future generations. I talked about the relationship between the factory farming industry and the advancement of dangerous zoonoses with Hans Saar, professor of blood-transmitted infections at the University of Amsterdam's Faculty of Medicine.
Hey, hallo.
Goedenavond.
Marianne Thieme.
Hans Saaier.
Ja.
Welkom op Sanquin, de bloedbank van Nederland.
Dankjewel, ik ben heel erg benieuwd.
Ik ga u rondleiden.
Hartstikke goed, doen we.
Deze kant.
Wat doet Sanquin?
Sanquin zamelt bloed in voor patiënten. En dat kan omdat ongeveer 400.000 Nederlanders dat gratis, zal ik maar zeggen, afstaan dat bloed. Dat is prachtig, ja. 400.000 donors.
Nou, we zijn hier omdat ik graag wil spreken over zoonoses met je. Wat heeft Sanquin te maken met zoonoses?
Ja, op het eerste gezicht zou je natuurlijk zeggen dat een bloedbank niets met infecties te maken heeft die van dier op mens gaan. Maar gek genoeg heeft Sanquin juist heel veel ermee te maken en het lijkt wel steeds meer. Bloed kan geïnfecteerd zijn en dus gevaarlijk voor de patiënt omdat bijvoorbeeld de donor een geslachtsziekte heeft opgelopen, HIV of hepatitis. Of omdat de donor terugkomt van een tropische vakantie en niet weet dat hij of zij malaria onder de leden heeft. Maar wat eigenlijk steeds meer problemen geeft, is dat je gewoon hier thuis in Nederland iets op kan lopen door gewoon te ademen. Dan denk ik aan Q-koorts in Brabant. Of door iets op te eten of op te drinken. En dan denk ik aan gekke koeienziekte. En dan hepatitis E.
En kon Sanquin dan wel al die bloedmonsters goed screenen op zoonoses? Want dat zijn er zoveel.
Het is een ongelooflijk hoop werk. Maar zowel voor de gekke koeienziekte als daarna de Q-koorts hebben we de maatregelen kunnen treffen, de testen kunnen doen, de donorselectie kunnen toepassen, waardoor we denken dat de bloedvoorziening steeds veilig is gebleven. Maar het is dus elke keer een dure, arbeidsintensieve klus, keer op keer.
Er is grote discussie over waar komen die zoonoses dan vandaan. Er is onlangs een onderzoek geweest van het Instituut voor Ecologie, waaruit blijkt dat bijvoorbeeld wilde eenden niet het virus meebrengen hier naar Nederland, bijvoorbeeld de volgpestvirus, maar het hier oplopen. Als je bijvoorbeeld spreekt over hepatitis E, dan wordt er gezegd, we moeten af van die wilde varkens, de wilde zwijnen op de Veluwe.
Ja.
Want die bedreigen eigenlijk onze volksgezondheid. Ziet u dat ook zo of is er een andere oorzaak?
Nou, het zou zelfs zo kunnen zijn dat die drie wilde zwijnen waarin hepatitis E-virus is aangetroffen op de Veluwe, dat die ooit misschien de bron zijn geweest, maar dat doet er helemaal niet meer toe. Want omdat we die enorme intensieve veeteelt hebben, zit daar het virus nu in. En daar vermenigvuldigt zich elk jaar dat virus op reusachtige hoeveelheden. Dus dat is het probleem. Ik denk dat we ons moeten realiseren dat we als Nederland toch wel misschien kampioen intensieve veeteelt zijn. Hè? Dus misschien niet een plek op de wereld te vinden waar je meer dieren zo dicht op elkaar vindt, op zo'n klein stukje grond. En ook zo dicht bij mensen. Hè? Als je mensen op elkaar propt, hè, vluchtelingenkampen, heb je ook binnen 1 tot enkele weken ernstige uitbraken. Cholera, vlektyfus, verzin maar wat. En als je dieren bovenop elkaar zet in zulke enorme hoeveelheden, is het onvermijdelijk dat je ook uitbraken krijgt.
Of welke donoren hebben dan de kans om zulke bacteriën of virussen onder de leden te hebben? Zijn dat met name dan boeren, dat ze veel met dieren werken?
Nee, dat zijn jij en ik. Dat is het gemene ervan. Als ik dat rijtje langs ga, gekke koeienziekte, 3 Nederlanders zijn gestorven. Dat ze toch een verkeerde hamburger hebben gegeten, zou ik maar zeggen.
Omdat ze een hamburger hebben gegeten?
Want het is verkeerd gewoon vlees, punt. En toen kwam het Q-koorts.
Ja.
In Brabant vooral, hè. Weinig mensen weten dat in Oost-Brabant 1 op de 10 burgers besmet is geraakt met die Coxella-bacterie, de verwekker van Q-koorts. 1 op de 10 was dat.
Ja.
Dat weten niet veel mensen. Zo enorm is toen die infectie druk geweest. Wat nu speelt, en wat ook veel Nederlanders niet weten, is dat ik geloof dat we per jaar 10 tot 20 miljoen biggen produceren.
Ja.
De meerderheid daarvan lijkt hepatitis E, een leverinfectie, door te maken. Onschuldig voor die biggen. Op dit moment heeft 1 op de 500 van onze donors, dus het zijn er meerdere per dag, hè. We hebben zo 2, 3, 4.000 donaties per dag. 1 op de 500 donors heeft het virus in het bloed, nu, vandaag. Ik denk dat ze het via voedsel oplopen, via varkensvlees wat toch niet goed gaar is. We zijn bijvoorbeeld bij hepatitis E de recordhouder ook in Europa. We hebben nergens zoveel bloeddonors met hepatitis E in het bloed als in Nederland. Ja, dat kan toeval zijn, maar we hebben denk ik ook nergens zo'n intensieve varkensteelt als in Nederland.
Dus op dit moment is er massaal sprake van een hepatitis E-uitbraak binnen de biggenhouderij.
Ja, ja.
Daar hoeven mensen niet ziek van te worden, nee. Maar als het gebeurt, wat voor een kwalen krijg je dan?
He, dus gezonde mensen kunnen er gewoon tegen. Misschien heb ik of jij nu hepatitis E-virus niks aan de hand. Maar als je immuunsysteem geremd wordt, omdat je je getransplanteerde nier niet mag afstoten. Of als je immuunsysteem helemaal platgelegd wordt, omdat je voor witte bloedkanker, witte bloedcelkanker, leukemie behandeld moet worden. Of omdat je zware afweerremmers moet slikken voor je reuma. Als je dan hepatitis E-virus binnenkrijgt, dan wordt het chronisch. En kan het verbindweefseling, dat heet cirrose, van je lever geven in een paar jaar. En dan kan je sterven aan leverziekte.
Nou wordt er gezegd, kijk, een zoonose is... kan gevaarlijk zijn van dier naar mens toe. Maar het wordt pas echt gevaarlijk als er een mutatie optreedt... waardoor het van mens op mens overdraagbaar is.
Nou, dit is waar. Zo'n virus kan een keer muteren en dan van mens op mens gaan. Maar dat hebben we niet eens nodig om het al gevaarlijk te hebben. Die infectiedruk vanuit de intensieve veeteelt... in de vorm van hepatitis E, in de vorm van Q-koorts... in de vorm van gekke koeienziekte, is zo hoog dat we dat hele mutatieprincipe niet eens nodig hebben.
Om al te kunnen spreken van een tikkende tijdbom in de veehouderij.
Juist, ja.
Ze zegt, ziekte, daar hebben we natuurlijk niet een regie over. Dat is iets van alle tijden, dat is natuurlijk. Maar we kunnen wel de risico's beperken.
Ja, absoluut.
Wat kunnen we doen om ervoor te zorgen dat we in ieder geval de regie daarover krijgen?
Persoonlijk denk ik dat... de oplossing nogal simpel is. We moeten minder vlees produceren en beter vlees. Dus ik denk dat dat economisch ook heel goed zou kunnen uitpakken. Ja, in plaats van 10 hele goedkope biefstukjes, 1 goede. In plaats van 100 waardeloze worstjes waar van alles in zit wat ik niet wil weten. 2 goede. Dan wordt dat ook veel duurder. Dan moeten we ook maar wat minder vlees gaan eten. Dat is alleen maar goed voor ons.
Nou is de roep ook heel vaak, vaccineer de dieren, dan zijn we beschermd.
Dat kan een oplossing zijn, soms. Dat ligt aan de ziektekiem of je al een vaccin hebt. Godzijdank blijkt bijvoorbeeld bij Q-koorts vaccinatie van de geiten een hele belangrijke factor te zijn. Maar het lukt lang niet altijd om een vaccin voor iets te maken.
Kunnen we het risico nemen door gewoon door te gaan op de ingeslagen weg?
Nee, ik vind het niet. Het is ook niet nodig. Het kan anders, dus dat risico moeten we niet nemen. Het is roulette. Het kan goed gaan heel lang en het kan een keer verschrikkelijk fout gaan. En dat weten we pas als het zover is.
Vind je dat de overheid nalatig is als het gaat om preventie?
Dat vind ik een moeilijke vraag. Persoonlijk vind ik meer dat de burger juist ook een taak heeft. Je moet gewoon geen plofkip meer kopen als burger. We moeten bewust worden dat we het gewoon niet meer willen kopen als consument.
We are breeding chickens who in 6 weeks... grow up from weighing a few grams into 2 kilogram chunks of meat in 6 weeks. Genetic variation and natural resilience are disappearing because the industry is breeding animals with an extremely accelerated growth development. In that respect, it merits noting that during the bird flu outbreak, wild birds did not die in great numbers, whereas the disease claimed masses of lives among the chickens and turkeys held in the factory farms. The Dutch Institute for Ecology and the Royal Dutch Academy of Sciences have recently shown that migrating ducks do not, in fact, bring the flu to the Netherlands. They catch the virus here instead. In 2005, a new bird flu epidemic was looming. Together with Stichting Wakker Dier, I started a campaign, Slow Down the Virus, Don't Eat Chicken. Because it's the mass consumption of meat that sustains these large-scale, intensive factory farming practices. Minister of Agriculture at that time, Kees Veerman, was outraged. The chairman of the Dutch Trade Union for Poultry Farmers called Wakker Dier a criminal organization, called me a criminal. 7 Dutch poultry associations filed an action suit and held Wakker Dier and me personally as a director liable for any potential damages. Pure intimidation. They demanded an end to the campaign because we were supposedly selling lies about the relationship between the poultry industry and the spread of the virus. As far as we know, the world had never before seen an attempt via legal system to silence a social organization with an opinion about the bird flu crisis. On a special campaign site, people could swear a chicken oath, promising to refrain from eating chicken as long as the animals were not vaccinated and the factory farming industry was made to take appropriate action. Visitors of the site were also shown an animation by Hugh Bertrams about the threat of bird flu with the presiding minister in a leading role. They could forward this viral movie to others. And the courts ruled against the 7 poultry organizations because, as the court stated, there was sufficient evidence to claim that there is indeed a relationship between factory farming and the avian influenza threat. And it also ruled that Wakker Dier had the right to call on people to eat less or no meat. It really was the first time I was faced with an extreme length to which the livestock industry is willing to go when their economic interests are jeopardized. I'd like to show this viral movie to you once more. In the past, we let animal diseases run their course. But since the onset of intensive animal farming, that's no longer an option. A bacteria or a virus has become a potential weapon of mass destruction due to the sheer scale of the livestock system. Now, when there is an outbreak of an animal disease, the government opts for the extremely cruel solution of gassing animals, sometimes tens of millions of them at once, only to restock the stables with animals a few weeks later, as if nothing ever happened. Politicians aren't capable of prevention, but have taken on the role of crisis managers, managers of crisis that they themselves have allowed to develop, time and time again. We need to organize a summit in the near future on animal diseases with all involved parties. And we must draft a Delta plan to contain the risks and remove the source of the problems. In any case, the social cost, including the cost of a pandemic, must be a standard component in the calculation of the cost price of animal products. For example, a meat and dairy tax could be a valuable step towards reducing the livestock numbers and lowering the risk of a pandemic. This tax could, at the same time, be used to create an animal disease fund. We will have to work together before a new elbow bump beats us to the punch. An elbow bump. Yes, you are hearing me correctly. The World Health Organization hasn't gotten much further than coming up with an elbow bump in case a pandemic makes shaking hands ill-advised. I can tell you from personal experience that when you warn people about the collapse of nature and the environment, and in turn the collapse of our children's futures, many people become irritated. Please stop spinning all that yarn. We're in the midst of an economic crisis here. Let's get that solved first before we worry ourselves with your tall tales. Well, I know quite a tall tale about turning our environment into petty cash. A Native American tale, to be precise. In 1626, the Dutch bought the island of Manhattan from Native Americans for 60 Dutch guilders. The Dutch also purchased Staten Island from the Native Americans. They paid with trowels, exquis, cooking kettles, and beads, also worth 60 guilders. In 1854, Suquamish Indian Chief Seattle delivered a legendary speech. Oral history has left us with a number of different versions, but its essence is uncontested.
What is it that the white man wants to buy? My people will ask. The idea is so strange to us. How can you buy or sell the sky? The warmth of the land? The speed of the antelope? How can we sell these things to you? And how can you buy them? Is the earth yours to do with as you please? Just because the red man signs a piece of paper and hands it to the white man? If we do not own the freshness of the sky and the sparkle of the water, how can you buy this from us? Can you buy back a buffalo once the last one has been killed? But we will consider your offer, for we know that if we do not sell, the white man will come with guns and take our land by force.
...114 years ago, Robert Kennedy said words to that same effect. He too said that we express all our desires and needs in terms of money. We pay more attention to money than to all those things that truly make life worth living.
Our gross national product now is over $800 billion a year. But that gross national product, if we judge the United States of America by that, that gross national product counts air pollution and cigarette advertising and ambulances to clear our highways of carnage. It counts special locks for our doors and the jails for the people who break them. It counts the destruction of the redwoods and the loss of our natural wonder in chaotic sprawl. It counts napalm and it counts nuclear warheads and armored cars for the police to fight the riots in our cities. It counts Whitman's rifles and Specs knife and the television programs which glorify violence in order to sell toys to our children. Yet the gross national product does not allow for the health of our children, the quality of their education, or the joy of their play. It does not include the beauty of our poetry, or the strength of our marriages, the intelligence of our public debate, or the integrity of our public officials. It measures neither our wit nor our courage, neither our wisdom nor our learning, neither our compassion nor our devotion to our country. It measures everything in short, except that which makes life worthwhile.
Nature, the diversity in plants, animals, and ecosystems represents the greatest asset on our planet. They are literally of life and death importance. But they are also valuable in and of themselves. It is the most valuable asset the Earth has to offer, because it is the basis of all life. Without biodiversity, there's nothing for us to eat, no clean air for us to breathe, no water clean enough for us to drink, It is critical natural capital. It defines our lives. We can't substitute it once we've ruined it. The diversity of life on Earth is declining at a shocking rate. Since the dawn of life on Earth, new species have emerged, and others have become extinct, sometimes slowly, sometimes in enormous numbers. But the process we are witnessing today, I'm afraid, is unprecedented. The rate at which species are currently vanishing is estimated at 100 to 1,000 times higher than ever before. One in four mammals, one in eight bird species, and one in three amphibians on this planet are at risk of becoming extinct. The Living Planet Index conveys a somber message. Over the past 40 years, wildlife population have decreased by an average of 50%. Most threatened are fish, reptiles, and amphibians that live in freshwater. The loss of biodiversity is greatest in tropical regions. In Latin America, the losses are tragic. 83% of the species diversity in this part of the world has been lost over the past 40 years. Hot on its heels is Southeast Asia with 67%. Rainforests are vanishing before we even have an inkling of what they may have to offer us in terms of preserving and promoting our health. In Africa, rhinos, elephants and lions are still slaughtered in staggering numbers. For their horns, their tusks, their hides, or just for the entertainment of rich Westerners. Climate change is threatening the existence of the polar bear on the North Pole. The demise of these species confronts us as humankind with our own mistakes, our vanity, and our own short-sightedness. The loss of species is due to many reasons: climate change, land use, agricultural pesticides and artificial fertilizers, deforestation. The list is endless. Deforestation is one of the principal global causes of the large-scale loss of biodiversity. Every year, millions of hectares of tropical rainforests are cleared for our appetite for wood, agricultural land for cattle feed, and land used for human settlement. At one time, 1/7 of the Earth's surface was covered in tropical rainforest. Today, hardly half of that is left. Every minute, an area equal to approximately 50 football fields of rainforest is lost. The lungs of our world are disappearing. The biggest culprit: soy plantations for feed. That is what's making the forests of South America disappear. Over 30% of global biodiversity losses is due to the production of meat, dairy, and eggs. Because this uses 80% of the global agricultural land area. And that percentage continues to rise in order to meet the demands for soy and maize of sectors such as the Western factory farming industry. Instead of age-old trees in the Amazon, you see endless soy fields. In Southeast Asia, palm oil plantations have taken the place of nature. If the current rate of deforestation of the Asian forest continues, there will be nothing left in 20-odd years. The orangutans are threatened with extinction because they have no more place to live. And closer at home, we see that our bees, too, are dying.
Let me tell you about the birds and the bees and the flowers and the trees and the moon up above and a thing called love.
Op dit dak staan 4 van mijn 8 bijenvolkjes. En in totaal zijn er al 6 bijenvolkjes dood. Deze hier leven nog. maar deze niet meer. En dat kan ik jullie eventjes laten zien. Het waren heel veel bijtjes, dus het was een heel groot volk. Ze hebben ook nog heel veel honing, dus er is geen sprake van tekort aan eten. Deze die hebben nog genoeg. Het is echt heel vreselijk. Als je hier kijkt, je ziet ze overal zitten. Kijk, hier zitten allemaal dode bijtjes. En het ergste komt nog. Als ik namelijk die bak optil, dan zie je hier een zee van dode bijen. Allemaal prachtige beestjes die nu dood zijn. En zo heb ik van de 8 volkeren heb ik er nog maar 2 over die nog leven.
De bijensterfte is nu heel groot. Normaal zou zo zijn 8-10% van de volken die de winter niet overleeft. En we zitten nu al een aantal jaren op rij boven de 20% met uitschieters naar 30%. Waarbij 1/3 van alle volken de winter niet overleeft. Dat is natuurlijk veel te veel.
This massive bee mortality is not exclusive to the Netherlands. It's a global issue. And the consequences for us and for our environment are extensive.
Voor de voedselproductie betekent het dat bepaalde voedselgewassen duurder worden. En voor de natuur zijn de gevolgen veel groter, want daar kun je het niet zo goed opvangen. En zo'n 80% van alle bloeiende planten op aarde, die heeft ook die bestuivende insecten nodig. De wilde bijen, de zweefvliegen, de vlinders, noem maar op. Voor de zaadcyclus, zodat zaden gevormd worden en die planten zich voort kunnen planten.
60% van de groenten en het fruit dat wij binnenkrijgen is door bijen bestoven. In China zijn ze al bezig met kwastjes de peren en de appels te bestuiven. En zijn ze nu ook zelfs gestopt met appels verbouwen, omdat het niet meer te doen is. Dus onze voedselzekerheid gaat keihard achteruit zonder die bestuivende insecten. En dan heb ik het alleen maar over ons. Maar er zijn ook bijen die op 1 bloem vliegen. En die bijen en die bloem horen bij elkaar. Die soorten horen bij elkaar. Als die bij uitsterft, is de bloem ook weg. Dus een dubbele klap voor de biodiversiteit. En dan wordt de wereld toch een stuk minder leuk van.
Bees are crucial to the pollination of wild plants and food crops. Without pollination, many fruit trees will no longer bear fruit, which means we'll have to do without tomatoes and string beans and chocolate. Almost 3/4 of agricultural crops that nourish us depend on bees and bumblebees for their pollination. And without pollination, an estimated 80% of all wild plants will become extinct. Over the past 10-15 years, we have seen a frightening mortality among bees and bumblebees. All signs point out agricultural toxins as an important cause, particularly in areas with intensive agricultural farming, with its heavy use of pesticides, insect mortality is very high. According to independent scientists, especially neonicotinoids are major contributors to these deaths. These extremely toxic pesticides, with a potency to be 7,000 times more toxic than the prohibited DDT. These are systemic insecticides that are absorbed by the plant itself. The agent makes the entire plant toxic. Any insect that eats from the plant is affected. No, this is not salad dressing. How much of our biodiversity do you think still exists in the Netherlands? 60%? Who think that? 50%? 25%? It's only 15%. Much less than other European nations. We have very intensive agriculture in the Netherlands with monocultures, artificial fertilizer, manure from the livestock industry. And despite laws and policies drafted to improve the protection of biodiversity, the Netherlands has still not been able to stop the overall decline in numbers of its plants and animal species. Quite the contrary. I spoke about this issue with the specialist in the field of nitrogen, Professor Jan Willem Eresman. Het Wereld Natuurfonds heeft in 2014 het Living Planet Report uitgebracht, waarin staat dat we nog maar de helft van het aantal planten en diersoorten hebben op deze aarde. We weten dat biodiversiteitsverlies ontstaat door klimaatverandering, landgebruik en verdwijnen van leefgebieden voor planten en dieren. Maar jij hebt aangetoond dat stikstof ook een belangrijke factor is voor het verdwijnen van zoveel soorten. Kun je dat uitleggen?
Ja, stikstof is heel zeldzaam in de natuur. En omdat dat zo minimaal is, weet de natuur processen te ontwikkelen die zorgen dat die stikstof efficiënt gebruikt wordt. En daardoor krijg je een hele rijke natuur, want er is een hele interactie tussen bacteriën, schimmels, wortels, planten en daarna ook verderop in het voedselweb. Wij gebruiken stikstof omdat we voedselbehoeften hebben. En na de Tweede Wereldoorlog werd er gezegd, nooit meer een hongerwinter. Dus we moeten die landbouw zoveel mogelijk richten op de productie verhogen. En dat hebben we in de landbouw goed ontwikkeld. Kunstmest voegen we toe aan planten, waardoor die harder gaan groeien en dus meer biomassa opleveren. Meer kwantiteit.
Ze gebruiken in de landbouw heel veel stikstof in de vorm van kunstmest. Daardoor krijgen we hoge productie en we hebben veel monden te voeden. Mensen zouden zeggen, we moeten doorgaan met kunstmest.
Nou ja, het doel bereikt, ja. En ik denk ook dat iedereen dat in zijn hoofd heeft of haar hoofd. Van ja, we hebben de landbouw met kunstmest, dat gaat goed. Dat is alleen maar goed, want we krijgen steeds meer voedsel. Wat we ons onvoldoende gerealiseerd hebben, en Nederland is daar een lichtend voorbeeld van, is dat je ontzaglijk veel lekken van stikstof krijgt naar het milieu. Je bemest niet alleen het land zelf, maar door die lekken bemest je ook de natuur via de lucht. Door die lekken belast je het grondwater, de rivieren. En overal gebeurt hetzelfde als in die landbouw, namelijk het is een stof die zorgt dat er meer gaat groeien. Alleen op die plekken en natuurgebieden, daar wil je helemaal geen vergrassing van heide hebben. Nee, je wil juist dat die arm blijft om die biodiversiteit in stand te houden.
Want je krijgt dus steeds bepaalde plantensoorten die groeien van stikstof. Ja. En andere planten die veel minder stikstof nodig hebben, die juist daardoor verdwijnen. Dus dan krijg je ook veel meer monoculturen, dus zelfs in de natuur.
Zelfs in de natuur creëer je monoculturen, ja.
Boeren zijn managers geworden. Ze proberen met allerlei technieken de productie zo hoog mogelijk te brengen. Wat zijn de lange termijn risico's daarvan?
Kijk naar de bodem. Je schakelt eigenlijk de belangrijkste processen in de bodem uit. Maar dat niet alleen. Je zorgt dus ook dat de kwaliteit van die bodem afneemt. Er wordt geen organisch stof meer gevormd. Bepaalde schimmelrijkdom verdwijnt. Bepaalde bacteriekoloniën. Allemaal die je nodig hebt in je voedselsysteem. En dat schakel je uit, dus dat betekent dat op de lange termijn gaat je bodemkwaliteit achteruit. En als er iets is wat je nodig hebt voor voedselproductie, is het de bodem.
Dus wij brengen door het vele gebruik van kunstmest onze voedselvoorziening in gevaar?
Ja, door het overmatig gebruik zeker, ja.
Professor Eresman's story is alarming. The Netherlands is in the midst of an unprecedented biodiversity crisis. We have only 15% of our original biodiversity left, and even that 15% is under threat. According to Eresman, the recent massive bee mortality is exemplary for the crisis that we are currently facing.
Ja, voor mij is dat wel duidelijk, ja. Ik denk dat er een sterke relatie is tussen de manier waarop wij voedsel produceren en bijenachteruitgang, maar ook andere biodiversiteit, jazeker.
Ja. Wat zijn nou de belangrijkste factoren voor de bijensterfte?
Belangrijkste factoren zijn de voedselvoorziening. Dus de monocultuur die we gecreëerd hebben in de landbouw, waardoor er geen voedsel is meer, weinig voedsel te vinden voor de bijen. De bestrijdingsmiddelen, waardoor ook de bijen aangetast worden. En de bij is gevoeliger geworden voor virussen, hè, natuurlijke virussen die voorkomen, maar die nu massale sterfte veroorzaken. En dat heeft te maken met de weerstand van de bij, die ook afgenomen is. En dat heeft weer met de voedselvoorziening te maken. Dus er zijn verschillende factoren voor.
It is evident that the agricultural sector has a key role to play in the preservation of our biodiversity. But that requires brave choices.
Over 40 jaar moeten we 9 miljard mensen voeden. Kan dat dan zonder kunstmest?
Het kan in ieder geval niet zonder stikstof. Stikstof heb je nodig om de planten te voeden. En voldoende stikstof om voldoende productie te hebben, heb je nodig. Dus je zal heel erg moeten zorgen dat je de stikstof terugbrengt in de kringloop. Wat daarnaast nog van belang is, zijn de landschapselementen. De biodiversiteit alleen op het land zelf en de bodem is niet voldoende. Die ondersteunen eigenlijk die functie van de biodiversiteit in het land. Dan heb je het over heggen, hagen, akkerranden, sloten. Die zorgen dat er een bepaalde interactie is tussen die biodiversiteit in de bodem en op het land en in die randen zelf.
Wat moet er gebeuren?
We moeten naar een echt veerkrachtig landbouwsysteem, waarbij je de gebruik maakt van de biodiversiteit van de natuur als basis om je voedsel te produceren. En wat mij betreft moeten we naar een echt groene revolutie.
A flexible and sustainable agricultural sector. A real green revolution. That's the key for the preservation or even the recovery of biodiversity. But serious policies that will take us toward a sustainable and flexible agricultural sector are sadly lacking. In the meantime, banks finance more and more palm oil and soybean plantations, and governments continue to facilitate an increasingly intensive livestock industry. We need a ban on the import of soy and palm oil responsible for the destruction of rainforests. And we need a ban of agricultural toxins such as neonicotinoids. But until that ban is in place, please stop buying non-organic flowers or flower bulbs. Isn't it bizarre that you plant flowers in your garden and that the bees that are attracted by these flowers subsequently drop dead? Please maintain your garden without pesticides and insecticides. And we have to make sure that the existing natural habitats on Earth remain intact and, where possible, are connected to one another. Fragmentation is bad for biodiversity. But above all else, we need to change our consumption patterns. So we all have to become vegetarians, right? I can read your mind. Solve all global problems with a knife and fork, eh? Well, I'd say you're on the right track. It's too simplistic to say that all our problems are caused by the way we deal with animal proteins, but the fact remains that our current production methods are untenable. And it's not just the people from the Party for the Animals that say that. also organizations like the World Bank, the UN, the World Health Organization, the FAO, the International Panel on Climate Change, the Dutch Scientific Council for Government Policy, the Environmental Assessment Agency, the World Watch Institute, a recent Chatham House report, and the US Dietary Guidelines Advisory Committee. So it's actually a quite generally accepted concept, which is supported by Al Gore, Bill Clinton, Paul McCartney, Prince Charles, and many others. Even the Dutch government acknowledged that meat is the most environmentally unfriendly part of our diet. We have the insights, now we need to change behavior. I would like to conclude with a quote from Martin Drenten and Jozef Keulaerts. They are environmental philosophers at the Radboud University and Wageningen University. They said, "The enormous diversity in species and ecosystems is a kind of wealth. When one species becomes extinct, so does a particular way of life and a perspective on the world that will never return." Human existence on this planet would be much more impoverished and lonely if we would only be surrounded by our own species and our own creations. Other species enrich our existence because, for example, they have a totally unique take on the world and confront people with an external perspective. They hold up a mirror, inspire, fascinate, or fill with fear. They give meaning to the world, our world, one single planet. And this planet deserves our undivided attention. There is a world to be won. And everything we buy, choose, eat, use, and share. Your money or your life. Is the glass half empty or is it half full? In a country with as much water as the Netherlands has, this question hardly seems relevant. There is an abundance of water and it costs next to nothing. In fact, we have so much drinking water that we actually use it to flush our toilets. We have always had it and we always will have it. According to the Dutch proverb, to have money like water is to have an abundance of it. Indeed, just like water. Issues with water are to be found elsewhere in the world. Faraway places with serious flooding problems or extreme drought. At home, everything is under control. We're all right. We live on a planet of which almost 3/4 is covered in water. Deep in our earth lies enough water to fill our oceans 3 times over. There is no other planet in our Milky Way that has as much water as the Earth. And when we venture into space and conduct our research, we always ask the same 2 questions. Is there water? Can this place sustain life? The probability of water on Mars accelerates scientists, even though we hardly take note of the water on our own planet. Gandhi said that the world has enough for everyone's need, but not for everyone's greed. And that should be the starting point for the debate on scarce resources, in which water proves the main bottleneck. There is no life without water. We can hardly fathom that water could ever become scarce in a country such as the Netherlands, a country which was conquered from the water through drainage projects by windmills in polders. And yet, that's exactly what has happened. Of all the water on the planet, less than 1% is potentially suitable as drinking water. Less than 1%. If we think of the world water stock as two long drink glasses, then one is filled to the brim with salt and therefore undrinkable water. And the other contains just a single teaspoon of fresh water. That's the ratio. And that same teaspoon is claimed by the most affluent humans. Today, 750 million people do not have access to clean drinking water. According to the United Nations, in 2025, almost 2 billion people will live in countries or regions with an absolute water scarcity. And 2/3 of the world's population will be faced with water shortages. Climate change is causing the glaciers to melt at a staggering rate. A large part of the world's population is dependent on meltwater. Glaciers are, so to say, the storage tanks of our freshwater supply. And those storage tanks have sprung a leak, caused by global warming. In Brazil, you can actually see how current human activity disrupts age-old rain patterns. The rainforests that created their own clouds through evaporation of water from their canopy have given way to endless soy plantations. Now, farmers complain of droughts, which is especially painful when you consider that they themselves were responsible for disrupting the water cycle. The majority of the fresh water stock is locked in the bedrocks beneath us. This groundwater has collected here over thousands of years, which essentially makes it a non-renewable resource. But groundwater reserves are being depleted at a frightening speed. The water is used as cooling water in industrial processes and evaporates or is dumped after use, often so heavily polluted that it can no longer be used. Hey, but it's free and nobody owns it. So why take any heed? Conflicts over water aren't a thing of the future. Tensions are already rising between countries and peoples, between Egypt and Ethiopia, for instance, over dams in the Blue Nile, and Pakistan and Bangladesh against Indian intervention in the Indus or the Ganges. And Israel is only willing to leave the Golan Heights and the West Bank if it can continue to access the water from these areas. There are many examples.
One of the most bloody water wars is still being fought over the River Kaveri that farmers of Karnataka and farmers of Tamil Nadu both required more water out of that river. A bandit of Tamil origin, Veerappan, kidnapped a Karnataka actor with the demand that large amounts of water be released to Tamil Nadu. It was really as a chess game in the water wars. I was doing a major study on conflicts over resources for the United Nations University. This fat file of mine on river water conflicts suddenly had no more coverage because the entire issue was now being presented as an issue for religion. not water demands and water conflicts. So many water wars are presented as religious conflicts, when in reality they are fundamental conflicts over resources.
Large corporations such as Coca-Cola and Nestle make it their business to extract water from countries' aquifers. They bottle it and subsequently sell it at startling prices to the people who actually own the water in the first place, the population of those countries. They do it even in countries with serious droughts. This is how it works.
Lagos is the largest city in Nigeria, and probably in Africa. Some 15 million people live here. The vast majority of the population is dependent on packed drinking water. The water is well packed, but it's not always pure. Sachet water is frequently the cause of bacterial infection, especially among children. Nestle Pure Life has been available in Nigeria since 2005. Clean, safe drinking water in the upper price sector.
These are multinationals that understand the importance of water. They know that in Nigeria, water supply is still at its, you know, infantile stage, such that the government hasn't really taken proper hold of providing enough water for the nationals and for the citizens. So the industry is indeed profiting and exploiting the weakness of government. And in doing this, the person who is holding the wrong end of the stick is the ordinary citizen, who is helpless. He doesn't know how safe the water he is drinking is. Nestle Pure Life, a bottle of it, is more expensive than the daily income of many Nigerians. That Pure Life bottle is even more expensive than a liter of petrol. Only the rich can afford safe, clean water.
Scientists estimate that the major water and climate crises will lead to over 50 million refugees that will flock to the north of the planet in 2020. And in 2050, that number will have increased to at least 200 million people looking to build a new life elsewhere. Refugees from the island of Tuvalu have already been recognized by New Zealand as the world's first climate refugees. Their island is threatening to be swallowed by the waves due to the rising sea level. And the inhabitants of the Maldives, 350,000 people, are currently seeking collective asylum in another country for when their atoll disappears into the Indian Ocean. Talks are underway with Australia, with Sri Lanka, and with India. But no country is very enthusiastic about welcoming 300,000 refugees at once. This is a global problem that will also have a marked impact on Westerners. The Germans and the Dutch depend on glacial meltwater, feeding the rivers for 40% of their water. And at the same time, these Western countries are the place where refugees from all over the world go to. Problems of this scope are always uncomfortable, because you feel that you, as a mere individual, have little to no influence. The Netherlands have been at the vanguard of water-related issues for decades. We have world-famous dredgers that help raise and reinforce dikes, create new islands and deepen harbors around the globe. Climate change, rising sea levels, and severe storms mean that improved protection of low-lying countries against impending water is absolutely vital. But these technical solutions are not the answer to the growing demand for drinking water in the world. The government asks us to use water-efficient shower heads, But is that really making a difference? I visit Professor Arjen Hoekstra of the University of Twente, renowned worldwide for his groundbreaking research in terms of water footprints. I asked him what we can do about the world's water crisis. Je bent bekend geworden met je water footprint concept. Dat heeft vast heel veel teweeg gebracht.
Ja, het is zo dat voorheen bekeken we water eigenlijk altijd een lokaal goed, een lokale hulpbron. Mm-hmm. Moest ook lokaal gemanaged worden. Maar nu zien we dat water steeds meer gezien wordt als een mondiale hulpbron die steeds schaars wordt. En waar we dus allemaal mee van doen hebben.
Wat houdt het precies in?
Nou, de watervoetafdruk die laat zien hoeveel water er gebruikt wordt in de hele productieketen van een product. Dus zowel waterverbruik als watervervuiling.
Oké, dus je telt alles wat je gebruikt, tel je bij elkaar op?
Ja, over de productieketen.
Over de hele productieketen. En dat zet je dan af tegen wat we aan water beschikbaar hebben?
Ja, dat is natuurlijk heel belangrijk om te kijken uiteindelijk van hoeveel water er beschikbaar is. Dat wordt op deze kaart getoond. Die laat zien hoeveel water er ergens gebruikt wordt ten opzichte van hoeveel er beschikbaar is. En die kleuren geven een naam van geel tot rood. Dat is groter dan 100%. Dat betekent dat de watervoetafdruk groter is dan de maximaal duurzame watervoetafdruk. Dat betekent meer watergebruik dan er beschikbaar is.
Dus al deze landen in deze gebieden die zitten in de gevarenzone?
Ja, daar gaan grondwaterstanden naar beneden of rivieren of meren komen te hoog te staan. En dat zijn dan de gevolgen daarvan.
Ja, en je ziet ook veel groene gebieden. Nederland zit in het groene gebied. Zijn wij dan uit de gevarenzone?
Nou nee, het interessante is dat wij dus niet te maken hebben met waterschaarste direct, maar zo'n 3-4 miljard andere mensen wel. En in die gebieden worden de producten gemaakt die wij juist ook consumeren. Ze hebben zelfs berekend dat het 40-45% is van onze totale watervoetafdruk. Die heeft te maken met producten. Die komen dus uit die landen waar water nu onduurzaam gebruikt wordt.
Dus je zou kunnen zeggen dat wij mede verantwoordelijk zijn voor die droogte?
Ja, nou ja, verantwoordelijkheid, dat is echt zo'n politiek concept. Maar in mijn optiek hangen we daar direct mee samen. En is dat ook heel onduurzaam en lopen wij daarmee ook enorme risico's.
Ik maak mij grote zorgen over het feit dat steeds meer gebieden te maken krijgen met waterschaarste. 3 miljard mensen die zonder zoet water zitten straks. Dat kan niet anders dan tot grote spanningen leiden.
Het Wereldeconomisch Forum heeft nu net water genoemd als nummer 1 belangrijkste risico van mondiale impact.
Ja.
En dat doen ze omdat ze zien de bevolking groeit, maar wat belangrijk is de economische groei en ook de consumptiepatronen veranderen. Vooral meer vlees, meer biomassa, die leiden tot een steeds grotere indirecte watervraag.
Dus we gebruiken meer water dan dat er is.
Ja, daar komt het eigenlijk op neer.
Hoeveel water gebruiken wij in Nederland per Nederlander?
Nou, in Nederland is, en dat noem ik dan de watervoetafdruk, is 4000 liter per dag. Het heeft niet te maken met watergebruik thuis, maar meer met het watergebruik in de producten die je koopt. Nou ja, meestal, dus met name wat je in de supermarkt koopt eigenlijk.
En wat zijn dat dan voor producten? Waar moeten we dan aan denken?
Nou, van die 4000 liter per dag van onze totale watervoetafdruk is een kwart heeft te maken met het vlees dat we eten. En dan 15% nog eens zuivel daarbovenop. Dus dat is ongeveer 40% alleen al dierlijke producten.
Als ik mensen vertel dat vlees heel veel water verbruikt, dan denken ze, hoe kan het nou? Koeien en varkens, die drinken toch niet zoveel?
Nee, ze drinken natuurlijk niet zoveel. De dieren is het veevoeder. Het kost enorm veel water om dat te maken.
Sojamais.
En dat wordt heel veel geïmporteerd natuurlijk. Dat maken we hier niet zelf.
Mm-hmm.
En dat gebeurt ook heel veel in waterschaarse gebieden.
Zijn wij afhankelijk geworden van derde landen in ons watergebruik?
Ja, ja, jij zegt dat nu, maar ik denk dat elke dag. Ja, dat is zo, want niemand praat daarover, maar dat is wel zo. Nou, wij wonen in een heel waterrijk land, maar wat de meeste Nederlanders niet weten is dat 95% van ons waterverbruik is in het buitenland.
Nou, zie je heel veel campagnes in Nederland om je waterverbruik te verminderen, waterbesparende douchekoppen, daar ben jij niet zo'n fan van, geloof ik, hè?
Nou ja, dat, kijk, ik ben erg voor waterbesparing. Uiteindelijk is het natuurlijk zinvol als je minder doucht, ook omdat het heel veel energie kost, dus je bespaart energie. Maar het mogen duidelijk zijn dat je dus niet echt water bespaart. Als je bijvoorbeeld geen vlees meer zou eten, dan zou je 800 liter per dag besparen. Terwijl als je dus niet doucht, nooit meer doucht, en dat is natuurlijk best wel behoorlijk smerig, dan, ja, dan heb je een besparing van 50 liter. Ja, dus 800 liter is wat dat betreft natuurlijk veel effectiever.
In de Tweede Kamer hebben we regelmatig discussie over hoe kunnen we nou onafhankelijker worden van energie uit instabiele landen zoals het Midden-Oosten. Kunnen we nou eigenlijk ook wel een discussie gaan starten over hoe kunnen we minder afhankelijk worden van water uit het buitenland?
Ja, ja, dat is een heel vergelijkbare discussie. Nou, ik denk dat wij ons voedsel in Nederland, voor een groot deel in Nederland, moeten maken. En in ieder geval in Europa. En dat voor de meeste producten kan dat wel. Bijvoorbeeld ons fruit, onze granen. We maken helemaal geen granen meer hier, want die importeren we allemaal uit het buitenland. En heel veel van die producten zijn ook uit gebieden waar waterschaarste is.
Apparently, there are quite a few things that you can do to reduce your own water footprint. At waterfootprint.org, you can see what your daily groceries cost in terms of water. This helps us make more conscious choices about what you can buy or don't buy. For example, a dozen fair trade roses from Ethiopia costs 120 liters. A cup of coffee cost 140 liters of water. One glass of dairy milk cost 255 liters of water, and one glass of soy milk cost 74 liters of water. 200 grams of meat substitutes, such as corn, which contains chicken egg, cost 200 liters of water. The same amount of steak, 200 grams, cost approximately 15 times more water, at least 3,000 liters. One 100 gram bar of chocolate cost 1,700 liters of water, and a pair of jeans, 8,000 liters of water. So the greatest waste of water isn't due to our showers, but to our shopping trips and our meals. In 2013, requested by the European Union, Professor Hoekstra and his Italian colleagues conducted research into how certain changes in your diet can significantly reduce our water footprint. From this research, Europe was subdivided into four regions. The results clearly show that a vegetarian diet drastically reduces the water footprint in all four regions. Meat consumption is highest in the west and south regions of Europe. A shift to a meat-free diet would have a huge impact. Switching to a vegetarian diet in these regions would lead to no less than 41% lower water consumption. Fish consumption wasn't even factored into this research because there was insufficient data available to do so. But we do know that when fish is included in the calculation of the water footprint, the numbers would be higher still. And so the solution lies in a change in behavior by the 7 billion passengers of spaceship Earth, as Wibble Ockels described it. Those who are most affluent today have the greatest chance of setting the right example, to turn the tide, literally. As you shop the mall and sit at the dinner table, you can make a major difference to the world's water consumption, and in turn, significantly impact the availability of fresh water for people who need it most. After all, as the globe's largest consumers of water, we should be a major part of the solution. When we founded the world's first political party for the animals in 2002, many people responded with a mixture of disbelief and horror. How dare someone found a party for the animals when there are children starving in Africa, when wars are raging and refugees are on the run, when people are unemployed and we are running out of natural resources? When there are so many human problems that call for immediate solutions? Isn't the party for the animals against that backdrop sheer decadence? A form of species betrayal that prioritizes animals over people? Everyone who asked me that question back then received the same answer. The problems of animals and humans are inseparable. People and animals share a small planet that has lost its balance, mainly as a result of what people do to animals. I brought that into focus in the documentaries Meet the Truth and See the Truth, but there is more to say on the subject. The decisions we make in the kitchen do not only impact what we will serve for dinner. They also define what the world will look like for our children. That may seem like a problem for distant future, but it is approaching fast. Scientists expect that around 2020, there will be millions of environmental refugees who make their way to the Northern Hemisphere in search for food. Anarchy is no more than 9 meals away. That's not a title of a cheesy Hollywood film or a conspiracy theory propagated by doom mongers. It is the analysis of the British member of the House of Lords, Lord Cameron of Dillington. Lord Cameron is also a farmer and head of the UK's Countryside Agency. He warns about empty supermarket shelves and what that will lead to. But it's difficult for us even to imagine, because supermarkets today still offer a cornucopia of foods at lower than ever prices. But our food supply is teetering dangerously close to the edge. In 2050, according to the UN Agricultural Organization, FAO, we will need 60% more food in order to feed the growing world's population. This while the Earth is already under severe pressure. Our way of life has derailed the Earth's natural cycles. Nobody, except maybe the odd veggie patch enthusiast, is actively involved in its own food supply. And our generation in the West has never personally experienced real hunger. We live in an era of abundance and cannot imagine that could ever change. The animation Super by Johan Klungel, the Dutch entry for the Oscars in 2014, is a marvelous illustration.
Tasty. Tasty. Mm.
People in poor countries associate meat, dairy, and eggs with affluence. It is a symbol of status, which means that demands for these products will also skyrocket in the future. And in its wake, so will the prices. By 2030, food prices are expected to rise by no less than 70 to 90%. It is hard to imagine now, but it is going to happen. This means that there won't be enough affordable food to feed the world. But why will the food prices rise so dramatically? And why are we not able to help developing countries produce their own food? I discussed this issue with Special Rapporteur for the Right to Food with the United Nations, Dr. Hilal Elver. The UN rapporteur points out to countries their obligation to guarantee a sustainable food system. The UN concludes that only ecological agriculture will be able to feed the world. Their studies reveal the weaknesses of the current intensive and large-scale farming methods. This causes a lot of commotion in the mainstream food industry.
Bilbao, the north of Spain. This is where I meet Professor Hilal Elver at the Parabere conference. She's here to speak on behalf of the United Nations about the world food issue.
What is wrong in our food system? Number one, we are producing too much food. Number two, we are wasting too much food. Number three, we are using too many resources for this. Number four, we are using agricultural land not for food production, but for biofuel, animal food, and commodities. There's a serious issue. Thank you very much.
Hello.
Hi.
Marianne Thieme.
Very nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. We're still facing a lot of hunger in the world, and we're also facing a growing population. Is there a need to increase the food production?
Well, when you ask this question, generally they say yes, but I think I would say no, because we need a food, but the right food, not the kind of industrialized, more commodified food production, which is extreme resource using issues. So we need a right system rather than a very yield-oriented policy.
The FAO predicts that food prices will rise dramatically. Why is that?
Because the existing system is very much based on fossil fuel economy and energy, and they are expecting that fossil fuel prices will be high, and then we have less agricultural land right now because many of them are already used. And the climate change also will affect food prices.
Yes. So food prices will rise because of it's connected to the fossil fuel industry.
Yes.
But animal feed dictates also food prices. And when the meat consumption will rise in upcoming economies, then we really have a problem.
Yes, of course, because almost 40%, I think, the animal that agricultural production goes to the animals. So if this will be reduced, then will be significant kind of space to regular food that people eat. Think about it, 40%, it's a huge amount of land and production goes directly to the animal.
Can you even say that giving so much soy and maize and all kinds of grains to animals for the meat industry is really a violation of the right to food?
Definitely violation of the right to food, because we are competing with the animal food and the people's food. But in traditional way, there is no competition. There is a kind of combination between the two.
Companies like Monsanto say that they feed the world. They work on food security by producing rice that is very healthy for children and so forth. What do we think about that?
Well, this is a first of all big ambitions. They're not going to feed the world. We know that, and they never did, and they're not going to do it because corporations, not only Monsanto, there are other corporations doing the similar kind of things, but the Monsanto is the biggest one that we hear a lot. First of all, the idea of the corporations is making a profit. Anything profitable is good for the corporations. So, yes, okay, you're going to try to give the rice to poor people, but the farmers should pay for it. It is not going to be free. So what will be the argument of we're going to feed the world and only with rice and putting a little bit vitamin to rice rather than diversifying vegetable, which is very important, and many of the projects that are doing this, not only rice but next to rice field it has to be some vegetables, which is very important in case of extreme emergency, for instance about the extreme weather event, still they have something to eat. So this kind of big time of argument that feeding the world, whoever says this, it's a false.
What's the most sustainable choice one can make?
Let's put it this way, responsible agriculture is extremely important for the future, not for just the solidarity, but thinking about the planet.
Genetically engineered crops of companies like Monsanto aren't going to feed the world, says Dr. Elver. She worries about the fact that our food supply is increasingly controlled by multinationals. This trend should be of concern to governments. She says that governments should play a more decisive role in a transition to a more sustainable food system. Small-scaled, locally sourced, and with a production geared at feeding humans. A real green revolution.
It's a real green revolution, you're right. Well, of course, governments also should regulate something, but some libertarian thinks that we should not really interfere people's lifestyle. I think this is beyond the lifestyle, this is a protection of our future.
When I talk about cut down meat consumption and that the government really has to stimulate people to eat less meat, they say, well, we can't prescribe people what to eat or what not to eat. Then you really violate human rights.
Well, they say this, but if you look at the TV, what corporations are doing to us? We are hearing every day, every 24 hours, our children especially, they are bombarding by these commercials. So they are trying to change our lifestyle or eating. So this is also against our rights, right? Then they should regulate then corporations, that corporations should not really push the people eat the wrong thing. Because we have to go to this direction. We have no time, we have no way to go business as usual. It's so obvious from my perspective and from many people's perspective, agroecology is the future.
If the rest of the world will consume as much meat and all the kinds of products as we, the Westerners, do, what would the world look like?
There will not be any world in the future. So,
current hunger is not the result of insufficient production. No, not by a long shot. We throw away one third of all the food we produce. And when we consider the yields of all the agricultural fields in the world, it is shocking to have to conclude that nearly half of it is used as cattle feed and not for direct human consumption. It is used to feed factory farming in the West. The food issue we are now facing is about wasting food, about what we eat and how we can properly distribute food. The Netherlands wants to be the world's butcher and milkman. Our country has the most livestock animals per square meter, 450 million animals per year. The majority is concentrated in the province of Noord-Brabant. The residents of this province became immediate victims of the animal diseases such as acute fever and deal with high concentrations of fine particulates. People there are extremely concerned about public health and animal welfare and are forced to witness how one mega stable after the other pops up in their area, each housing tens of thousands of pigs or chickens. It's no surprise that the provincial administration of Noord-Brabant formed a committee to investigate how the livestock industry can be made more sustainable. And at the presentation of their report, the committee chairman, Daan van Doorn, said something very insightful. He stated that in order to maintain our current consumption pattern, we need an equivalent of four planets Earth. Four planets Earth. The chairman also proposed a curious solution. Therefore, we'll have to further intensify our farming practices. We must build more factory farms in order to meet the growing demand for food. That's what he said. Maybe his recommendations have something to do with the fact that this chairman worked at the largest butcher in Europe. But they are the basis now of the agricultural policy in the Netherlands. So further intensification and producing on an even larger scale are the only answers the architects of our current agricultural system have to offer. Continue to upscale production to meet the short-term demand for food. But Einstein already knew. We cannot solve problems by using the same kind of thinking we used when we created them. We are at a crossroads. Are we continuing the current path, the path of massive scales, intensification, and more? Solutions we are offered today are, if we breed sows that have more piglets, we will breed sows with more nipples. If cows emit too many greenhouse gases, we will put them on an artificial diet. We keep pigs in completely confined stables with energy-guzzling air cleaners that are meant to filter out fine particulates and nitrogen. If we cannot sell parts of chickens and pigs in Western countries, we will dump them in Africa and Asia without giving a thought to the potential long-term consequences. It is a mortally ill system. A system with enormous risks of diseases and infestation. It is the path of free trade that allows us to kill off agricultural economies in developing countries through unfair competition. But there's also another path, an agricultural system that coexists in harmony with nature, the environment, with humans and animals, where we join forces with nature in an intelligent manner instead of fighting nature with agricultural pesticides, with closed natural cycles and without using artificial fertilizers, where farmers receive a fair price for the food they supply and natural processes are giving room to run their course, where we no longer waste food but harvest in order to feed the world. And to achieve such a world, we will have to start eating differently. Why feed 25 kilos of cattle feed to a cow to get 1 kilo of meat in return, if we can utilize the agricultural land that is now used to grow feed to produce food that will be used to feed people directly? According to research by the University of Minnesota, we could feed an extra 4 billion people with the current agricultural land area simply by choosing not to process crops to make feed and biofuels. The Dutch Scientific Council for Government Policy, one of the principal advisory bodies of the Dutch government, recently determined that we should stimulate a lower consumption and production of animal proteins. And recently, Dietary Guidelines Advisory Committee of the American government also recommended a substantial decrease in the consumption of animal proteins, also in the interest of public health. The world's great minds have known for a long time that we need to change. In 1918, Konrad Adenauer conceived a soy-based sausage in order to feed the world. Albert Einstein predicted in 1932 that a plant-based diet was the best option to promote health and feed the world in a sustainable manner. And in 1936, Winston Churchill thought of the concept of laboratory meat. They were far ahead of their time. We have no more time to lose now. And it's nonsense to believe that we aren't capable of changing the system. We have to revolt against the sick system that exploits farmers and animals and leads to starvation, climate change, water shortage, biodiversity loss, and animal disease crises. By changing the way we consume, by changing the way we live, and by inspiring others to make sustainable choices. Fork and knife are our mightiest weapons to preserve the world for future generations. One single planet, enough for everyone's need, but not for everyone's greed. The Earth provides a solution to every problem, but for every solution, there is an economic interest to block it. If we put an end to our short-term, human-focused thinking, this can bring us closer to solutions for mankind, for animals, nature, and the environment. Is there anything I can do? Is there anything you can do? Certainly, we all can. Thank you so much for listening. I'm sure we'll meet again. It's a small world.